Dear friends, good morning. This is episode number 6. It relates to execution of decrees and orders. And today I am dealing with the subject arrest and detention. After episode number 5, normally one will expect me to take sections 46 and 47. 46, as I said, precepts important that I will deal with while dealing with the subject attachment. Section 47 is very important and to some extent complicated. I will deal with the same only after finishing the important topics in execution. Now we go to the subject arrest and detention. The relevant provisions are sections 51 to 59 and Order 21, Rules 11A, 22, 37 to 40. Order 21, Rule 11A, 22 and 37 to 40. I said about sections 51 to 59. Strictly speaking, fifty-two, fifty-three, and fifty-four, we can avoid discussion being discussed in this chapter because that will come while dealing with certain other subjects. Now let us see section 51. I referred to on an earlier occasion about the powers of the court under section 51. I also said that it is a reservoir of powers. We will again go to section 51 because it is very important. Powers of the court, that is on making an application by the decree holder, the executing court will order execution of the decree by doing the following things. Clause A, by delivery of any property specifically decreed. I mentioned that Order 21, Rule 35 is relevant in this context. Clause B, by attachment and sale, or by sale without attachment of any property. Section 60, Section 65 to 67, and Order 21, Rules 41 to 54, 58, and 64 to 104 are relevant in that matter while dealing with the Clause B. Clause C, by arrest and detention in prison. That is our today's subject. Then D, appointment of receiver, Order 40, in Clause E, in such other manner. So today we will concentrate on Clause C, by arrest and detention. For enforcement of decree, various modes are provided. If I have to realize a decree amount from you, I can realize it by arrest and detention, your arrest and detention in civil prison as provided in the CPC. The procedure is contained in sections 55 to 59. and the rules in Order 21 which I just mentioned. What are the safeguards to be taken before arresting and detaining a person in civil prison? What are the things to be proved by the decree holder to enable him to get an order in his favor for arrest and detention? What are the defenses available to the judgment debtor if he is really entitled to those defenses? What reliefs are entitled, parties are entitled to, etc., etc., all becomes relevant. A proviso is there in section 51 that is of constant application in courts. What is a proviso? Just look into the proviso. Provided that where the decree is for payment of money, execution by detention in prison shall not be ordered unless after giving the judgment debtor an opportunity of showing cause why he should not be committed to prison. The court, for reasons recorded in writing, is satisfied. Showing cause occurs under Rule 37 of Order 21. Now, what are the things which the court has to satisfy itself? One, the judgment debtor must be given an opportunity of showing cause why he should not be arrested and detained. And then the court must record the reasons for so doing, for sending a person to prison. Then the order should also mention the satisfaction of the court as to the ingredients for the purpose of, to be proved for the purpose of sending a person to a judgment debtor to civil prison. Just because the decree amount has not been paid by the judgment debtor, that is not a ground for sending him to prison. Suppose the judgment debtor is penniless, he has no income, he has no property, he has no deposit, he has no realizable asset, then can such a person be sent to jail? No. For realization of the decree amount? No. Cannot be. If he has committed a crime, even if all these things happen, he can be sent to jail. But not for a realization of amount under a decree. If he is not having any means to pay the decree debt, or a substantial part of the sea. I will come to the clause which are relevant here. I was just mentioning that before sending a person to civil prison, the court must give him an opportunity of being heard to show cause as to why he should not be committed to civil prison. Then the court must record its reasons why it is sending a person to prison. The order must reflect the satisfaction of the court that the grounds which are mentioned in the proviso exist. Now, what are those grounds? 1. A. The judgment debtor with the object or effect of obstructing or delaying the execution of the decree. So he does obstruct or delay the execution of the decree. There are two clauses there, 1 and 2. To obstruct or delay the execution of the decree, the judgment debtor is likely to abscond or leave the local limits of jurisdiction of the court. 2. has, after the institution of the suit in which the decree was passed, dishonestly transferred, concealed or removed any part of his property or committed any other act of bad faith in relation to his property. These are the two clauses under clause A. That is, in spite of the obstruction tactics, delaying tactics made by the judgmentor by undertaking any of the activity in clauses 1 and 2, subclauses 1 and 2, the court may send him to civil prison. Dishonestly transferred, removed, concealed, etc. says about a contumacious conduct on the part of the judgmentor. There must be utmost good faith in the activities of the judgmentor so long as he does not pay the money under the decree. It is not for the decree holder to search and find out the judgmentor and coerce him to pay. When a decree is passed, it is the judgmentor's duty to satisfy the decree. It is true that for execution of a decree, a period of 12 years is available under Article 136. For some other decrees, a lesser period is provided. But normally, all other decrees will have a period of 12 years. Somebody may ask, why such long period of 12 years? Why not, after passing the decree be executed then and there? My answer would be, if that is the only method, many of the decrees will not be satisfied. For example, if the decree holder is not able to prove that the judgmentor has the required means to pay the decree debt, or in other words, the court is satisfied the judgmentor does not have the current means to pay the decree debt, it will not send him to civil prison. But later, he comes with the money, he obtains money, he is a rich man. Cannot the decree be satisfied from him, realized from him, decree amount be realized from him at a later point of time? It can be done. Just closing of an execution petition on the ground that the judgmentor does not have the money to pay, he does not have the means to pay the decree amount or substantial portion of the same, that is not an end of the matter. Tomorrow he gets a lottery for 2 crores. Your decree amount is 5 lakhs. Why not the amount be realized at that point of time? If the entire thing is to be closed immediately after passing the judgment and decree, and nothing should remain, it must be a clean slate, then there are pitfalls for the same. Many of the decree holders may suffer. That is why the legislature provided a period of 12 years for executing a decree in the normal circumstances, with just exceptions, mandatory injunction, etc. And for prohibitory injunction, Article 137 says, of the Limitation Act says, that there is no period of limitation. It is a continuous one. So it is not a correct proposition to say that immediately after the decree is passed, everything should be finished and the whole proceedings should be closed. Nothing should remain in the court. No party should be able to approach the court for redressal of his grievances. That is not correct. There is a purpose for it. Now, we come back to clause A of the proviso to section 51. We mentioned about the two clauses, about the satisfaction of the court to be recorded, etc. Then B. B is the most important thing that may happen in any court, executing court. That the judgmentor has or has had since the date of the decree the means to pay the amount of the decree or some substantial part thereof, and refuses or neglects, or has refused or neglected to pay the same. See the wording? Each word is important. judgmentator has, that means the judgmentator has what? The means to pay the decree debt or a substantial part of the same. So that speaks of the current means, or has had since the date of the decree the means to pay. Then that is not enough. And he refuses or neglects, or has refused or neglected to pay the same. Refuses or neglects, the expression refuses or neglects relate to the current means. The word has, that is a current means. The judgmentator has the means, but he refuses or neglects. The judgmentator has had since the date of the decree the means, but he has refused or neglected. These are the two parts. A past action by refusing or neglecting to pay, in spite of the fact that he could have paid, cleared the decree amount substantially or in full or substantial part of the same, and he did not do so. Refusal or neglect, refusal is a positive thing. Neglect is, though it is, may appear that it is not a positive thing, it is also, it also amounts, there is a contumacious contact on its part. Neglecting, I neglect. I am bound to do something, I neglect. Is it not a contumacious contact? So that is being dealt with under clause B. So the decree holder, the court must be satisfied that either the judgmentator has the current means to pay, present means to pay the decree debt or a substantial part thereof, and he refuses or neglects to pay the same. Second aspect is, the judgmentator has had the means to pay the decree debt or substantial part thereof, and he had refused or neglected. This is, if you read the commentaries, you will get hundreds, thousands of decisions of various courts on the point. In every, almost every execution petition for realization of decree debt by arrest and detention, one of the contentions will be the plea of no means by the judgmentator. When such a plea is raised, it is for the decree holder to prove that the judgmentator has the necessary means or has had the necessary means as provided in clause B of the proviso to section 51. Then clause C, that the decrees, we will come back to clause B again, that the decrees for a sum for which the judgmentator was bound in a fiduciary capacity to account. Explanation says, in calculating the means of the judgmentator for the purpose of clause B, there shall be left out of account any property which by or under law or custom having the force of law for the time being in force is exempt from attachment in execution of the decree. Section 60 deals with attachment, what all properties can be attached, and after saying that all these items, following items, we will deal with section 60 in detail. Then the proviso says that the following items shall be exempt from attachment. One of the examples, the necessary wearing apparel of a married woman, thali and other things, cooking vessels, implements of artisans, bullocks, the seed to be sown by an agriculturist in the next season, agricultural implements. All these things are exempt. Salary, to certain extent, it is exempt. Certain, there is a calculation there under a particular clause that not the whole of the salary can be attached, but a portion is exempt. Then pensions, etc., gratuity, provident fund, all these things are dealt with under section 60. So for the purpose of calculating the means as provided in clause B, the exemptions must be taken note of. Exemptions which under law or custom having the force of law for the time being in force is exempt. Such exemptions must be taken care of and the means must be calculated only after excluding the same. Now, I will refer to two decisions of Justice Krishnaiya. One was rendered in the year 1969 while he was a judge of the Kerala High Court. And the other judgment was delivered by him in 1980 when he was a judge of the Supreme Court. Almost same points. Whether a person can be sent to jail for realization of a civil debt, a decree debt, to what extent it can be done, what is the relevance of the international covenants, etc. That is 69 KLT 927 is the decision of the Kerala High Court by Justice Krishna Iyer, 1969 KLT 927. The other is AER 1980 Supreme Court, AER 1980 Supreme Court 470. Equivalent citation KLT 1980 KLT 375. Within brackets, Supreme Court. The name of that case is Jolly George Varghese versus Bank of Cochin. The other judgment is Xavier versus somebody. I think it is Xavier's case. Just find out. Now, what is said in 80 Supreme Court? To quote the words of Justice Krishnaiya, I will quote because there is no, it is not proper to substitute my words for Justice Krishnaiya's words. It is unique, his language, his legal language and thought process are all different. I will quote, to be poor in this land of Daridra Narayana is no crime, and to recover debts by the procedure of putting one in prison is too flagrantly violative of Article 21. Unless there is proof of the minimal fairness of his willful failure to pay in spite of his sufficient means and absence of more terribly pressing claims on his means such as medical bills to treat cancer or other grave illness. Unreasonableness and unfairness in such a procedure is inferable from Article 11 of the International Covenant on Human Rights. The words which hurt are, quote, or has had since the date of the decree the means to pay the decree amount. This implies, superficially read, that if at any time after passing of an old decree, the judgmentor had come by some resources and had not discharged the decree, he could be detained in prison even though at that later point of time, he was found to be penniless. So these are all to be balanced by the court executing the decree. Technically speaking, if after passing the decree, the judgmentor has had the means, but he did not pay, that not paying need not necessarily be attributable to refusal or neglect. That is why I mentioned that there is some positivity. Mere non-payment would not amount to neglect. Suppose there are pressing needs. Marriage of the daughter of the judgmentor, treatment of the wife of the judgmentor, and the money realized or money which came in his hands was utilized for such pressing needs or his own treatment, or he met with an accident. He was treated in the hospital for several months. All the money which he earned by that time was spent. All these are pressing needs. Just because I have a decree debt to be satisfied, I cannot refuse to treat my wife or children, or solemnize my daughter's marriage on the ground that I have to pay money under a decree. I may think that later let this marriage be over or let the treatment be over, I will make money and pay it. That is not a contumacious contact. And as I said, see, the court, it is a very difficult task for the executing court to find out. Many a time proper evidence will not be led by the financial institutions, particularly nationalized banks. They do not have that mechanism to find out the whereabouts of this judgment debtor. There are judgment debtors and judgment debtors. There are majority of them refuse to pay. They evade payment, avoid payment by adopting all techniques, particularly when the amount is to be paid by a bank or other financial institution. It is seen from experience that they are very reluctant to pay. And several decisions, you have to read the commentaries. It is not proper in this episode to deal with all those decisions and mult it with a voluminous thing. Now, clause C, that the decree is for sum which the judgmentor was bound in a fiduciary capacity to account. What is fiduciary capacity? It is a relationship of mutual trust and confidence. A case which I argued before the Kerala High Court, and it was decided by Justice P.K. Balasubramanian. I was appearing for Metal Industries, a government company which is situated at Shornu. There was a cashier, Krishna. He misappropriated, the allegation is that he misappropriated money from the industrial unit company. A suit was filed by Metal Industries, suit was decreed. And at the time when he was a drunkard, he spent all the money which he misappropriated for other purposes, his own purposes, by indulging in activities which are undesirable. And then at present he does not have any money. He was thought to be arrested and detained in civil prison. Then the question arose. He said, I do not have any money now. I do not have the job. I lost the job in the metal industries because I was dismissed from service. I do not have any property. I do not have any deposit. I do not have any money at all. Don't send me to jail. How that question is to be addressed? If clause C applies, all the other defenses are not available. Because it is a relationship of mutual trust and confidence. The cashier of a government company is in a fiduciary relationship with the government. And if that relationship is established, then the ingredients of clause B, that having the resources and not paying it, neglect, refusal, all those things are not necessary. If it is not paid, that is an end of the matter, because the contumacious contact is always there. Plus, the mutual relationship of trust is there. Therefore, in that case, it was decided like that. That is, the citation is 1992 2 KLT 519. Krishnan versus Metal Industries Limited. Then what is means that is realizable asset? There are decisions right from 1950 Madras or so. 30s Madras High Court has held what is means is realizable asset. So if you go to the commentaries, you will get thousands and thousands of decisions. And we will deal with the rest of it in the next episode. Thank you.